from you this morning. Let's continue to worship. We're going to sing this song, Our God is Love. I'm so thankful for a God that loves us, that is concerned about us, that has great plans, and is working behind the scenes for us. Let's sing this out.
Come. His face shines brighter.
Amen. Amen. You know, man, there's just something about the name of Jesus, man. The Bible says that when the demons hear the name of Jesus, they tremble at his very name. The Bible says that at the end of the world, that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And aren't you grateful that we're in the house today? Amen. That lifts up the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Listen, you guys look awesome today. If you've got seats by you, man, people are trying to still come in, squeeze in just a hair. We'd love for everybody to have a seat this morning. It'd be great. But while you're doing that, just say hello to somebody close by. Bump a fist, shake a hand, hug. Whatever your comfort level is, you guys look awesome. You may be seated. Thank you so much for being out here on a hot and humid October. Anybody bitter about that besides me? Come on, somebody. It just doesn't feel right. There's pumpkins out there and they're sweating. Even the pumpkins are sweating. The ghouls and the goblins are all dying out there. Well, they're already dead, so whatever. Hey, listen, this is the part of the service where we take up our tithes and offerings, and we thank you so much for contributing to the work God is doing, not only here, but around the city and even around the globe. And this last week, we introduced to you something we call Love Week SA, where we are encouraging all of us to go out and do our part to let San Antonio and surrounding communities know how much we love them. That our church is not just about folks coming up in here, but for us to send people out to just love on the city. And we've got a whole bunch of opportunities. And as you leave today, as you walk out the doors, you're going to see a tent set up out there. You saw it when you came in. Filled with opportunities for you to volunteer. I know that a lot of you have the tomorrow off. And I know you're going to do something fun, but man, maybe you just mix in a little service to our community. This part of this church's culture and DNA has always been, since day one, that we love our city and that we serve our city and we love the people of the city and we reach for them the best we know how. On the back of your LifePoint notes, and I've got mine all wrinkled up and professional looking for you there, see how powerful that looks. But right there on the back of your LifePoint notes are several opportunities. Tomorrow we'll be partnering with Hufford's Elementary. This is our partner school that we serve all year long, from fill a backpack, fill a box, light your world. We just try to love on this school that's in an underserved part of our community. Matter of fact, our keyboard player, Webex Gil, this is the home of Gil. This is where he went to school, ladies and gentlemen. Gilbert Zertucci. So we're going to go tomorrow, and we're going to do some beautification, some landscaping things. There's an incredible organization called Agora that meets on the Near West Side. They have a location there. We're going to serve them two or three different times during the week, and I'm not going to tell you all about it, but we'd love it if you would take some time out this week just to love on our city. We're going to take some checks to some of these places based on what you guys give us today, and not just today, but all throughout the year. Part of our mission here is to take at least 10% of every dime that comes into this church and send it back out into our community and around the globe. So thank you so much, ushers. Go right ahead. Hey, take a look at the screens for some stuff that's happening around here at LifePoint. God bless you.
Good morning and welcome to LifePoint. Here are some events happening this month. There will be no rope track today due to child dedications being held after service. Rope track will continue next week. Come join us Saturday, October 31st at our church property from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. for a fun time of trunk or treat. We are looking for families who would like to decorate their trunks and pass out candies. Please email ruthie@lifepointsa.com to sign up. If you have a student in grades 6 through 12, then join us tonight for small groups. Groups begin at 6 p.m. For a list of host homes, please visit our website or check our Facebook page. Going Country, if you actively serve on the Dream Team, we want to celebrate you. Save the date for October 25th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at our church property for family fun. Invitation to follow soon. It's Love Week. Visit the tent on the patio after each service to sign up for some awesome serving opportunities this week.
Yeah, thanks again so much for being here today. We're so glad you're here. You know, today is a special day for me because we have a guest speaker with us today. His name is Jim Kilgore. His wife is Nancy. Wave at us, Nancy, real quick. I said this to the first service, but it's just a shame that we didn't think about making her sing or asking her to sing. You don't make anybody sing, see? But I don't know if anybody remembers Anita Baker. You guys feeling any? She's like the white Anita Baker. I'm just telling you, man. She's fantastic vocalist, recorded a lot of stuff along the way, and so we're glad to have you, Nancy. They've got three beautiful children, but let me tell you about Jim. Jim, first of all, was my boss and my pastor at the last church that I worked at in Houston, Texas, a church called Life Church. And just a fantastic leader, fantastic visionary, has built a great, great church in Houston, a legacy kind of a church, doing great work all over the world. But one of the things that I love about him, first of all, you know, there are folks around that, you know, man, they say, that guy's a good this or that guy's a good that. But every now and then you have the opportunity to say, man, not only is this guy a great preacher and a pastor and visionary, but he's a great Christian man. And I learned so much of what I know about how to lead people and how to love people from Jim Kilgore. Just a man with a tremendous heart, which you're going to hear and feel this morning. But he started an organization, an orphanage. And he's going to tell you the story today, just an amazing story, several years ago called Ima's House, and he named it after his mother, Ima Jean. And we have partnered with him in the past, and we will be sending money with him today as he leaves today as well to support that mission. But this guy is a fantastic man. He's been a mentor of mine. We love Jim Kilgore, and I want you to give him a humongous life point. Welcome as he comes.
Thank you so much, Danny. I am just thrilled to be here. Great service, first service. Just my wife and I'm so glad my sweet wife is with me. I'm glad that she's here on Love Week. We're celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary in just a few weeks. During the first service, we just were talking to each other about incredible love that we feel here and the purpose that God has planned for this church. And I'm just thrilled to be here. We absolutely love Danny and Rachel. And the years that they worked with us there at Life were really some of the best years of ministry for us. They were incredible in their ministry and in helping us. And just so thankful to see what God has done for them here and what's taking place. You guys look awesome. I agree with Danny. This is just the feel, the spirit of the Lord that is here. There's no doubt in my mind that God has just got something really special for Life Point. You know, I was privileged to be in some of the first conversations about Life Point with Danny and Rachel. As a matter of fact, when I interviewed Danny to come work for me, the first thing he said was, I feel like God's called me to plant a church in San Antonio. So I'm going to come. I'm going to give you 4 good years. And that's what he did. And then as the planning started, and just to see what God, to God be the glory.
Amen.
Aren't you thankful for what God is just doing, filling the purpose of God? I walked through the kids area just a few moments ago and walking through the parking lot and seeing the smiles and just the great spirit of God here. I'm just overwhelmed. And Danny and Rachel, I'm so proud of y'all. I'm so proud of what God is doing here and what God is going to do. It's going to be amazing.
Amen.
And I'm looking forward to seeing it. Well, I'm thankful that I could be here today to talk about discovering purpose. And it really ties into Love Week. It really ties into the expression of God's love. And as I have grown up in the church, as I have walked with Christ, as I have entered into ministry, there's one thing that I have discovered, a great revelation. You might want to write this down. This is pretty deep and amazing. And it's just simply this. God knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
God knows what he's doing.
Amen.
And sometimes when you're in the middle of situations and you're in the middle of problems or whatever it is, whatever life throws at you, you have a tendency to question, God, what's going on? Why is this happening? But as you get to a place where you can look back over your life and look back, and unfortunately, I guess I'm old enough now where I can look back and say, yeah, I can see that. That God has helped me and God has walked with me through situations. And while I may be towards the end of my ministry or close to it, it does give me a great strength to be able to look back and say, man, God is amazing. Look how He walked me through every situation. Look how He helped me. Look how He has things in His purpose. And so I would say to you today, with this great revelation of God knows what He's doing, you are here for a purpose. You are here in His plan. You are following what God wants for your life and what God has dreamed for your life. The thoughts that God is thinking toward you, that's what Jeremiah chapter 29 and 11 says, that He is thinking toward us. In other words, He's hurling these thoughts at us on a daily basis. And the scripture says they're thoughts of hope and of a future. Not of disaster, not of things going wrong, but of a hope and a future. That's what God is thinking about us. That's what God is putting in our life. And I truly believe that He has a plan for this church as a body. He builds the body. He fitly joins it together. And also, I believe that He has a future. He has a plan for every individual that is in this room. On your little list of scriptures there's only two passages. I'm going to read the second one first if you're following on your notes. And the second one is Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 10. That passage of scripture says, for we are God's masterpiece. Yeah. God's masterpiece. In other words, He's the one that is making us. He's the one that is creating us. It goes on to say, He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things that He planned for us long ago. Amen. He has plans for us, and these plans are from long ago. I love this passage of Scripture, and it is one of those passages that shows us the incredible love that God has for us. First of all, that He would consider us His masterpiece. Now, the original word in the Greek is poiama, poiama. And it's really something that we hear a lot because that's the word that is interpreted in the English language, poem. And it really represents a work of art. It's a poem, but in the original language, it's sculpture, it's painting, it's whatever would be a work of art. And so what God is telling us here is that when He chooses us and when we walk with Him, there is a shaping and a forming that goes on in our life through Jesus Christ that create us into an incredible masterpiece, an incredible work of art, an incredible an expression of what the artist is doing in our life. That's really what art is.
Yeah.
Art is the expression of the artist's imagination. Mm-hmm. Now, I know that there are some artists that they paint a reality. They look at a landscape and they paint the landscape. And if you held a picture up of the landscape, you would see, man, it's just amazing how it's like taking a picture. Or they paint a portrait of someone that is just so dead on. It's like someone took a picture of that. But even in those, the artist has a way of pouring his imagination onto that canvas or onto that painting. I mean, think about the Mona Lisa. It's just a painting of a woman. It's just a portrait. And yet it has become so incredibly famous and so incredibly renowned. People from all over the world travel to see it because the artist poured in just a touch of his imagination, the twinkle of the eye, the uplifted of mouth into a slight grin, and the conversations that have taken place over that one painting.
Yeah.
Because it was the expression of the imagination of this artist. That's what God is doing in us. As we come and walk with Him, and as we worship, and as we surrender our life, God is creating in us an incredible masterpiece.
Someone once walked in and Michelangelo was working on this big piece of granite, this big stone, and he was chipping away at it. And that the question, according to legend, is, hey, what are you doing? He said, there's an angel in this and I'm trying to release it. He was carving an angel. And I believe that God looks at us and sees something so incredible and so alive and so full of passion and so full of love and so full of purpose that when I come to church, I believe the artist is working on my heart and he's shaping me and forming me to be an incredible expression of his love to the world today. Because the imaginations of God and the expressions of God are expressions of compassion. They're expressions of love. The band sang it just a few minutes ago, but it wasn't original with them or the writer of that song. The origin of it was John. When John said in 1 John 5:8, God is love. And so when he works through us and when he walks into our heart and he shapes us and forms us, he truly is bringing forth an expression of his love. And the scripture also says that this has been done so that we can do the good works. Good works. There's works that God has for us. We're not saved by works. We're saved unto doing good works for people around us, for the world that is around us. And these good works are works that are beneficial to people. They're works that are profitable. They're works that are fruitful. They're works that flow out of our walk with Jesus Christ, our relationship with Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, because I'm connected to Him, it is a natural outflowing as the fruit of the Spirit that is in my life. I don't have to think about it. I don't have to even plan it. It's something that flows out of me because I am compelled because of the connection that I have with my Master, the connection I have with Jesus Christ. And so I'm thankful that there are works that I can be done, these activities that I can be a part of. And as your pastor read that list of things that you're going to do this next week, I love that. I love the fact that you're showing these love letters to the community. That's what it is. Life Point San Antonio SA is showing this. I love you, San Antonio. Yeah. This is the love of Christ flowing through us. I encourage you to get involved in that because it's an outflow of what God is doing in this building. I feel it in this building. I feel the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. I feel the heart of people that are worshiping. I watched the band and I watched you as that worship was going on. And after being in the church and pastoring for about 25 years now, I can sense that there is something here that God is building, an incredible work that He is accomplishing in this body. Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad that you're a part of it. I'm anxious to see what God will do. And when the church moves, now I believe that the Lord has something for everyone in this church to do inside of these walls. That's being part of the body of Christ, fitly formed together, doing our own special good work so that we can benefit those that are around us. Ephesians chapter 4. But I also believe that God has a calling for us outside of the walls, outside of the church. He has a purpose for our life. And the scripture that we've read here says that He has chosen those good works beforehand. He saw you. He walked with you as you came to Him. Now He's forming you and shaping you to be His expression of love to the world that is around us. I want to be an expression of love. When I think about how much God has loved me, how many of you are thankful just for the love of God?
Amen.
Just to discover that God really knows you, that God cares about you, that God looks into your life and He shows that love. That's amazing to me. And so I want to show other people how incredible that love of God is. And that love and that purpose of God has a way of transcending what society thinks. There are societal goals that we have. They start getting into our life when we're just very young, when we go through school, and there's some of them are very good. As a matter of fact, most of them are very healthy in their in the root of the goal, the root of being successful, of having a good education, of having a good job, of being stable. I mean, society benefits from people being stable, from people having jobs, from people helping one another, from marriages and families, and that's all good and well. But many times in a culture, and I believe that our culture has gotten completely out of balance because they take these societal goals, and all of a sudden that becomes our passion for living. And so all of a sudden, people are working for the next new car. And people are working so they can get a house with 300 more square feet or 1,000 more square feet. Or somebody's working hard because I've got to have a lake house. Or I've got to have a vacation. I've got to have an iPhone. I've got to have an iPad. And the problem with those goals is that they do not satisfy the purpose of God that's in our life. They do not fulfill what God wants to accomplish. And I am by no means preaching against those things. I think that you should do and be all that you can be. I'm just saying that there comes a time when you have to really weigh out what is really important in my life and what is really going to bring happiness. I can tell you that there were times that I wanted a new car so bad I could not stand it. Mm-hmm. And everywhere I went, you know what I'm talking about. I wanted this type of car. All of a sudden, every road I drove down, I would see one. Never even noticed them before. All of a sudden, man, look, there goes one. Oh, there goes one. I actually did an experiment one time. My wife and I were looking at a Camry, and I just thought, man, this is what we've got to have. We've got to have a Camry. I left the dealership, and from the time I left the dealership till the time I got home, I counted 35 Camrys. I hadn't even noticed them before. But can I tell you something? Once you get something like that, does it really satisfy you? Does it really make you happy? Does it really fulfill? I mean, it's a sense of satisfaction. It's a sense of accomplishment. But I promise you, within 6 months, you're looking at another car. Well, the Camry's good, but I should have upgraded to the whatever it is. I should have gotten the leather package. You know, it doesn't bring happiness. It doesn't bring fulfillment. My wife and I, years ago, built a nice house. And we thought this was our path in life. I remember the day we walked into it, the day that it became ours, the day we walked into it, and there was something in my heart that said, there's more than this. This is not the end. And I believe that God puts that in us to find His real purpose for our life, His real direction for my life. I want us to get good educations. I want us to have great careers. I want us to have nice cars, nice houses, iPhones, iPads, whatever it is. But I want you to also understand there's no eternal benefits for that.
That's right.
That's not something that you're building treasure in heaven over. That's not something that's satisfying the hunger of the spiritual man that is inside of you. I have been pursuing my purpose. I have been pursuing what God wants for my life. I can tell you that years ago, I was so caught in a rut and so caught in church and religion. And I had to just say, God, there's got to be more than this. And God led me. God helped me. God showed me some things. And one of the main things was my ministry. He reformed it. He reshaped it. I can take you to places where I prayed. I can take you to places where I sought God and I got incredible direction where God led me. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that we have received something from God fresh for this part of my life. But there was still something that God had for me that I couldn't even imagine was there. Let me tell you the story about it. Danny mentioned that I have a home in the Philippines that's an orphanage. It's called Ima's Home for Children. Ima was my mother, and I grew up watching her show love to so many people. The expression of her love was so incredible that when she passed in 2000, I always thought, I've got to do something. I've got to do something, a memorial for her somewhere. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know what it would be. And I spent my life in ministry. I spent my life investing in people. And one of those expressions of my ministry was to travel to countries around the world. And I really landed with my spirit and with my direction and with my time in the country of the Philippines. Has anybody here ever been to the Philippines? Raise your hand if you have. I love that country. I love those people. Who knows? My wife and I may end up living there the last part of our life. I don't know. I don't know what God has for me. But it was during this time that I would go. I started going in about 95, 96, and I was going two or three times a year. I was teaching, I was preaching, I was training ministers, I was helping build new churches, I was buying buses. I was investing in the Philippines on a certain level, but God had something deeper for me that I had no idea was even there. Looking back, remember what I said, that God knows what He's doing. Looking back, I can see the influences in my life that would bring me to discover what God had for me. But at the time, I didn't know what God had for me. And you that raised your hands, you'll relate to this. The traffic in Manila is like nowhere else on the world. Please, whatever San Antonio, Houston, Dallas traffic is, multiply it by 50,000. The traffic is unreal. And on one particular trip, I was there during the rainy season. And when it rains, whatever the traffic is, horribly. I'm going to be honest with you. I've taken trips that here would take 10 minutes, that there in rainy season took me 6 hours. 6 hours. And so one of these trips, it was rainy. And as a result, I spent a lot of time in the back of the taxi, going from the hotel to the venue that I was speaking at, the church I was ministering to. And it was on this trip that I became very curious about something. Now, let me tell you something about curiosity. The popular saying is curiosity killed the cat. And I don't agree with that. I believe that many times we're curious because the Spirit of God is telling us, look this way. Everybody say, look this way.
Look this way.
I believe that God is directing us. And so this curiosity came about because every time we stopped at a major intersection, there would be children from everywhere would walk among the cars. And the older ones, like the 9, 10, 8-year-olds, they would be selling things. They'd be selling little flowers for you to put on your rearview mirror, aromatic flowers, or they would be selling chiclets or even cigarettes by the pack or single cigarettes or all kind of things. But then there was a whole other group of children that were, you know, 5 and 4 and 3 that couldn't handle selling or exchange of cash. And they would just beg. They would just come to the window, and they would knock on the window, want you to roll the window down, give to them. And one of the things I always tried to do is when I left the hotel, stop at the lobby, get as many coins and little denominations of bills that I could so that I could give. And it just struck me as so strange. And I got to the place where when we would stop, I would look around for any adult. Where are these kids coming from? Whose parents? Where are the parents of these children? So eventually I asked the taxi driver. I told him, sir, where do all of these children come from? Where are their parents? I mean, it's raining. It's hard. They're shivering. And I don't see any adults overseeing them. I don't see anybody helping them. I don't see any safety for them. And he acted like he didn't hear me. Now there is a language barrier, although in Manila, probably 90% of the people that you meet will speak English. And I thought, well, he just didn't understand me. He didn't answer me. And so we get to the next red light. Same thing happens. And I say, sir, what's going on with all of these children? And he said this to me. He said, it's the shame of the Philippines. The shame of the Philippines? What are you talking about? He said, sir, these are street children. They don't have any parents. They live on the streets. They beg for a living. And I am sitting in the back of this taxi, and all of a sudden I am overwhelmed with, my God, what do I do? You see, that's what curiosity, when the Spirit leads you, the next step will be, what can I do about the situation? What can I do to insert myself to make some type of help or some type of situation, a rescue? And that's what happened. I went back to the hotel room that night after I had preached. I got online. I started looking it up. I found that in the city of Manila, there's about 300,000 children that live on the streets. City of 22 million people. Man, that night it was hard to go to sleep. Next day I'm up going in the taxi and we stop at a red light. And I look over and there's a little girl sitting there, standing there at my door. She was about 5 years old and she barely came up to the edge of the door of the taxi and her hands are like this. Her face is pleading with me. Rainwater is dripping. She's drenched and she's shivering. And I say, God, please tell me what to do. It became a passion. It became more than just a curiosity. It became more than just a need. It became my passion. I am going to do something. God, tell me what to do. I couldn't give enough money to help all of those children. I can't take care of all of them now, but I can do what God has called me to do. And God, in that taxi, planted in my heart the thoughts of building a home specifically for rescuing these street children. I didn't know anything about building a home. I didn't know anything about the government. I didn't know anything about the social services. I just happened to have a pastor friend that I was very close to, and I shared the burden with him. And I want to tell you what happened when I was sharing the burden with him. He started weeping uncontrollably. And I'm like, wait a minute, dude. This is my burden. Don't try and get in here. You know how people try and jump onto your ministry? Oh, we're not. No, this is mine. Don't be crying like that. And he's sobbing. You know, he's just weeping. And I'm like, what's going on? He said, Pastor, I've never told you this, but when I was 8 years old, my mother drove me downtown. My mom and father had separated. When I was 8 years old, my mom said, get out of the car. And she drove off. And from the time I was 8 till I was 18, I lived on the streets. I'm like, God, it's amazing how you've put us together. Here I thought you were doing something just with me. And the whole time, I've made such good friends. He's like my brother. I call him my brother, his wife, my sister, because we're so close. God knitted us together before he ever even revealed the purpose that we would do together. And my friendship with them helped me walk through all of the issues, all of the ways of that I needed to go, and to purchase a land, to establish a corporation, to register with the Filipino government, to be set up specifically to receive these street children. And to God be the glory, through trips and prayer and finding. We have a property now that's a little over an acre, beautiful home. We're remodeling it right now for our children. They're all going to have separate little bedrooms with three or four of them in it. It's not a dormitory. We're not going to raise them to be institutionalized. It's their home. We're their family. And right now I have 43, if I remember correctly. I know that one or two just recently were reunited with their parents. And these kids, when they came, I was there for the... We opened it two summers ago in June or July. And the children came. There was about 10, 15 children that came that first week. I don't want to offend anybody, but I just want to be real honest with you. They were animals. They had been raised on the street. They fought. They scratched. They cussed us. There was one little girl that was 5 years old. Every time I got close to her, she would hit me as hard as she could. We would sit them down to eat, and the first thing they would do is take half the food and put it in their pockets, and then they would devour like an animal, just eat. They've been raised on the street. And I have watched God turn these children into students. I've watched Him pour Himself into them, and they get along. The little girl that punched me and was so angry, so full of anger. If I could tell you her story, abandoned, locked in a house for days at a time, she would crawl from her house to another house to steal food out of their kitchen. She was 5 years old, starving to death, and she fell and fractured her skull. And that's how they found her. That's how they took her from the parents. Well, the parents were gone. They went in and they found this little girl. so full of anger. When I sit down now, of course, this happens with all of them. If I sit down, there's going to be five of them in my lap. There's going to be three of them hanging on my back. They're going to be kissing me. They're going to be hugging me. I'm Papa Jim. I'm really is Santa Claus, because when I go, it's just fun. When I go, they don't have to go to school. We go to the water park. We go to the mall. We eat ice cream, pizza parties. But they have a place now. And it's because God opens something up for me. I was there last summer. I'm just going to tell you a couple of quick stories. I know that my time is about up. I was there a couple of weeks last summer, and the girl told me, Sheenie, the director, she said, hey, we've got two children coming. So I was, okay, I'm anxious to see new children. And when the van drove up, there was two children that got out. One kind of a short, pudgy little boy, about 5 years old. And they told me his name was Pattis. Another young girl got out, tall, beautiful, about 6-7 years old. Her name was Leah May. Now, I estimate their birth dates because we really don't know. We assign birthdays to them. We assign ages to them because we have no idea how old they are. We really don't know. I watched James, that's what we named him. I watched him when he got out of that van and he fell on the ground. And I'm telling you the cry that came from that little boy's heart. I've never heard anything like it. I've raised three children. I've endured complete, total meltdown fits in Toys R Us, screaming, kicking. I've actually just walked away and just looked like, I don't know whose kid that is. I've seen kids throw fits. I've seen kids cry. I've seen my children cry when they were hurt, when they were just, I have never in my life seen the deep hurt. The story of the little boy is, and at that time his name was Pattis, because he was named after the restaurant that his parents abandoned him at. And I'm not blaming the parents. The pressures there are completely different than what we face. And perhaps they thought that if they kept the boy, he was going to starve. I don't know. Maybe they knew that. I don't know. I don't even try and reconcile that part of it because there's no understanding it. There's no way I can deal with it. Okay, I've got him now. I'm not going to worry about that. He's going to have love now. He's just abandoned at this restaurant. The name of the restaurant was Pattis. Sweetest little boy. I watched him. I knelt down. I got down on the ground with him that day and I just rubbed his back. I probably stood there an hour. I sat there an hour just rubbing his back, patting him, trying to show him, look, it's not going to be the way it was before. It's not going to continue to be that way. I was there on that particular day for about 4 more days. The last 2 days of that trip, if I sat down for a minute, he was on my lap. If I turned to walk, he was beside me holding my hand. Anytime I just stopped for a few minutes, he was kissing me on the cheek. And I told him, I said, he's not going to be known as Pattis. We're not going to let him go through life being named after a restaurant that his parents abandoned him at. We're changing his name. And because I am over the orphanage and because these kids come with no name, I have the ability to do that. I can create birth certificates for them. I can establish them with the government. And we renamed him. I named him James after my father. I wanted to give him the very best name. And my dad was the best man that I've ever known. And I wanted to give him the very best name because I want him to have such an incredible future that is beyond being abandoned in a restaurant. Leah May was another story. Here's a young girl that had gone through kindergarten. Her mother had taken her to her auntie. Said, this is Leah May's story. The mother said, I'm just going to leave her here. Can you watch her for an hour? I want to run to the store. And the auntie Rose said, yes, we'll take care of her. Mother never came back. Never been seen again. Auntie Rose was good to her for about a week. And then she got very impatient with her. She got very mad at her. And at the end of the second week, she opened the door and she told Leah May, 6 or 7 years old, get out. Leah May wandered the streets of Manila, I don't know for how long, until she finally found the school that she had gone to kindergarten. Walked in, found the kindergarten teacher, and the kindergarten teacher connected her with the social services. She comes to our home, lives with us now. I'm telling you, her smile will light up the room. She has incredible talent. She's a singer. I was there just a few weeks ago, and we went to church on Sunday, and she sang the solo. And I'm telling you, I was on cloud nine just to see her stand there. I'm not telling you any of those stories to build me up. I'm not telling you any of these stories to make me look good. I'm telling you those stories to let you know how rewarding it is when you find what God has for your life. Yeah. Because I'm going to tell you what happens when you find your purpose. When you find your purpose, you determine what's really important in your life.
That's right.
And when I came home and told my wife and God, she jumped right in with me. She said, we're going to do it. She wasn't hesitant. She didn't argue with me. We're in this together. It changed our life. It caused us to think about what really is important in life. And I'll be honest with you, that big house that I walked in, that I had such an empty feeling, it's sold. We don't live there anymore. We downsized. We went from 5,300 square feet to 1,900 square feet because we determined, you know what's important? What's important is those kids have shoes on their feet.
Yeah.
What's important is those kids have a meal to eat three times a day. I haven't bought a new car in 7 years. I like new cars. I want a new car, but I also know what's important. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I'm driving one now that is it is 16 years old. It is the cheapest car I ever bought. Paid $5,000 for it. I get more compliments on that car than any other car I've ever had. It's one of those old Jags. It's long. It's a classic look. I pull up to a gas station. People are like, wow, that is an awesome car. Yeah. I just act like it's a big deal. I don't tell them, oh, it's 90,000 miles on it. It cost me $5,000. Listen, I discovered what's important. I discovered direction for my life. I discovered what God wanted for me. It helps me determine what God wants. My prayer today, and I'm going to pray about this in just a few minutes. My prayer is that you will go beyond what society says is important, and you'll find out what God has planted in your heart to be an expression of love. Listen, when I go and those kids are loving on me and I'm loving on them and I'm thinking about what can I do for them and what gifts can I give them and how can I help them. And listen, I'm in it for the long haul. I'm building buildings that will take care of these kids until they're 18. I'm going to send them to college. I'm going to walk through their life with them. I'm their daddy. I'm their Papa Jim. I'm in it for the long haul. But when I do that, it's not me. It is the expression of God's love. I want to show them how awesome God is.
Yes.
I want to show them how deep God's love is. I'm going to close with this scripture. I hate that I've gone a little long, but bear with me. He said in the book of Matthew, he said, he will place the sheep at his right hand, the goats at his left. And the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you invited me into your home. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. Then these righteous ones, everybody say righteous ones.
Righteous.
They're not there saying I'm righteous. They're there and God is saying you're righteous.
Yes.
God is saying you are righteous. The righteous ones say, Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty, give you something to drink, a stranger and show you hospitality, or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you? Listen to this last verse. And the king will say, I tell you the truth, that when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you are doing it to me.
Yes.
I want you to think about that for just a minute. Jesus ties our relationship to him by how we treat others. And truly, if I am a masterpiece, the outflow of my life is going to be about the imagination of my Creator. He loves everyone I meet. But when I do it to the least of these, when I do it to the smallest one, it's a natural, it's a pure thing. It's not calculated. I want God to be happy with me. No, it's natural. If I love God, how can I help but not love His creation? But love His creation. If I love God, how can I avoid
an outpouring of compassion to the people I see that are in need. And my prayer today is that you would find your purpose. Be curious this week. Be curious. And when you're curious, let the Spirit lead you. I see Moses walking through the wilderness, and there's a bush on fire. There's curiosity. What is going on? Be curious this week. And when God gets you to that place where your curiosity is, wow, peaked, it's what's going on? Be open to the Lord saying, this is a need that you must have, that you must fulfill, that you must do. It is a natural reaction of the loving heart that God has placed in our life. I pray that your love that God has poured into you, the love that God has poured into you, will find a place to be poured out on people all around you. And that you will discover the purpose, not only in this building, but outside of these buildings.
Amen.
God to use you. Will you stand with me, because I want to just say a word of prayer over you. Thank you so much for listening to my story. I love to tell it. I love those kids. And I'm thankful, so thankful, LifePoint, for helping me and partnering with me. I just want to pray that God would open up what your purpose is, what He has for you. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this incredible day that you have given us. Lord, we have just loved worshiping you. We love sitting here together and just being with each other and feeling the purpose. We feel it. We feel it stirring. I don't know the names of very many people in this building, Lord, but you know every one of them so intimately. They're your works of art, guys. They're your incredible expressions of your imagination. You want to express your love to this world, and so you make us a masterpiece, a beautiful painting, an incredible sculpture, so that the world can see the work that you do in our hearts, God. Those works that you have that are good works prepared for us. Here is my prayer for every individual, God. Help them to discover what you have for them. Help them to discover that mission, that purpose that you have that will bring them the fulfillment that nothing in this world can give them. Help them to find that purpose that will make them so full of satisfaction that nothing in this world can bring. I pray even this week, Lord, as they drive through these streets, as they go into homes, as they go into work, as they read the news or watch the news, whatever it is, God, let curiosity, the spirit of curiosity, let it turn their head. Let them pay attention to what you're saying. And God, as that curiosity is satisfied and answered and they see the need, they become so impassioned by, I've got to do something. I've got to do my part, God. I've got to do what you've called me to do. I know that in that place there is such satisfaction. I know in that place my life really begins. It's the beginning of my life when I really walk into what you have for me. It's really the place that satisfaction and true happiness begins, Lord. It's there that I find out what's really important, what's not important, the direction for my life. And I pray for everyone in this room. I pray that the expression of love would flow out of them in a natural way to touch those around them. I want to stand there one day, Lord, before you, and I want to be on the side of the sheep. And I want you to look towards me and say, oh, righteous one, not because of what I've done, but because I have been a true expression of your creation and what you want to do. I ask it in Jesus' name. Everyone said in Jesus' name. Now I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm asking you to take about 5-10 seconds here. And from your heart, you can say it from your lips if you want to, but from your heart, I want you to just pray this prayer. I'm here and I am available. Will you do that with me right now? Thank you. Amen and amen. Can we give our great, awesome, mighty, wonderful God a great hand clap?
Hey, let's give Pastor Jim a huge hand. And thank you so much. Awesome, awesome, awesome. We're going to support Ima's home, and we're going to be a blessing to them. Hey, real quick, it's time for you guys to go. We're going to dedicate some children right after this service in about 15 minutes. Go pick up your kids, the rest of your family, the rest of you can just kind of be dismissed. About 15 minutes from now, we're going to start our dedication. Thank you so much for being out here today. God bless you. Have a great week, and somehow, go Cowboys. Come on, somebody. Amen.